What is up, my peeps? Joshua Smith here with another GSD mode interview. Every single week, we interview top entrepreneurs, top health and fitness professionals, and just straight up top badasses that are out there dominating their space. These are people that are choosing to not live a life of mediocrity, but instead to go out there and create big, epic lives for themselves and for their families. So today, you guys, we got a special guest on the show, a guy I'm really excited to have on the show. So this is, our guest today is Paul Burgess. He's the owner of Athletic Fitness Nutrition. So Paul is a health and fitness professional, specialized in fitness, nutrition, but a lot more than that. I mean, he goes deep, focusing on blood work, hormones, intolerances, DNA testing, working with world-class athletes. So really stoked and honored to have Paul Burgess on the show. Welcome to the show, my friend.
Thanks, mate. I'm stoked to be here. I'm a little bit concerned that you know that much about me in the intro, so I'm a bit scared about what else you know, but I'll do my best to get across to your audience what we need.
Yeah, no, I love it, man. And before we jump in, because I know that you're extremely knowledgeable, and I'm really excited to get into it pretty deep with you. But before we do that, you know, I'm really interested in your journey of what led you here. You know, because it sounds like you've always had this big health and fitness desire, you know, but most just get into kind of a typical personal training or, you know, but you went really deep with it, man. I mean, what led you to where you are today?
I won't do the whole story because we could be here hours, but I got into the fitness industry in a kind of a default kind of way. When I was very young, I started training and I was into my fitness and nutrition and enjoyed it literally from like 15 years old. But I didn't use it commercially. It wasn't a business of mine. And there was a time where I was involved with financial investments in the City of London and got very successful at that. And it just wasn't good for your health. And sometimes the money's not worth the price you pay. So I came out of that and a friend of mine owned a health club at the time and he wanted somebody to help run it. So I kind of fell into it that way many years ago. And whilst I was there, I thought, you know what, I might as well make this part of my living and what I want to do. And so I got qualified in the usual kind of personal training, but I also got qualified in clinical nutrition, anti-aging, that kind of stuff. This was many years ago. And so over the years, that's just expanded and expanded. And the more I look at stuff for myself, because ultimately, at the end of the day, I want to experiment everything on me before I'm going to advise it to any clients. So the more you dig into it, the more you find out that you can dig the hole as much as you want. You know, so I can go right the way from just eating what's called clean, right the way through to finding out, you know, how my hormones are working, what my blood tests are saying this week, what my liver enzymes are functioning like. You know, you can go right deep down a rabbit hole. So it all depends on how far you want to go. And personally, I want to go as far as it goes. So the more testing I could do, the more interested I would become. And the more I can then put that out into my client base, which appreciate it. Because we know exactly what's going wrong when we start testing properly.
Yeah, love it. So knowing what you know now today, do you still have the same theory or the same mindset of... you know, when you got out of being in the financial game, you know, right, that you were doing and it was really taxing on your body, you know, was that just because you maybe didn't have the knowledge that you have now today? With knowing what you know now today, do you feel that you could have made that a success with treating your body with the knowledge you have today?
Okay, so it was a huge success financially. And could you have done that and be healthy? I don't think the two work that well together. So you have to sacrifice something. It's like an athlete, okay? If you want to be a gold medalist at the Olympics, your health will suffer for it. You're not going to get to that extreme, put your body under that much stress, and keep everything working optimally. It just doesn't work, okay? At the same time, you can't sit on your backside on the sofa every night eating Haribos or donuts or whatever it is, and expect to be healthy. So there has to be a middle ground, right? You can't work 18 hours a day in the city and think your adrenals are going to keep up with that. It's just not going to happen, right? So knowing what I know now and what is important, which isn't money, but health, I know that, yes, you can make a good living. You don't need to make yourself hundreds of thousands, millions of dollars, or whatever it is, you can make yourself a very nice living, thank you very much, that pays all the bills and gives you nice holidays and does everything you want to do, and still be healthy, because you can instill a balance into everything. And that means you need to be proactive in your relaxation. I know that sounds like an oxymoron, but basically you need to book in time to do nothing, right? You need to book in time to meditate, to go out and just walk in places that bring relaxation to you, or there's lots of oxygen in, you know, big green leafy places and woods and by the beach and all that kind of stuff. And book it in like an appointment so that you make sure you go, because all of those things, they're the things that are great in life. When you don't have to worry about the stress and the office and the phone and everything else, you can just go and actually start getting in touch a bit more with yourself and how you feel. I think by bringing that in, you will, yes, sacrifice some of your earning capacity potentially, but at the end of the day, you will give your last penny to feel well if you're in hospital. So you need to strike that balance and get a perspective as to what's really important.
Yeah, it's one of those things where it seems like we spend all of our youth trying to make all of our money, and then we spend all of our later years, we spend all of our money trying to get back our health, you know, and
people are just more proactive about it.
All right, so you know, let's just kind of talk about where somebody would start, right? Because you've got so many people that are overweight, that you know, just aren't taking care of themselves, and things go so much deeper than just getting your typical gym membership and, you know, starting a diet and knowing if the diet's right for you. And, you know, and again, I know you're a guy that goes deep into blood work and knowing what's going on internally, not just what it looks like in front of the mirror, you know. So where would people start? I mean, is it always starting with the blood work and that process?
Not necessarily. I mean, we get clients that come to us and we don't do any blood work with them. It all depends on what their goal is, what they're trying, where they're coming from, what state they're in, and honestly, how much they want to spend. Because if you walk in and think you're going to spend $200 or $300, it's not going to happen. If you're going to come in and spend $2,000 or $3,000, then yes, we're going to do some good work with you. And that's not because we're greedy and we want to charge a lot of money. It's because the labs charge a lot for the complicated tests. You know, there are no cheap tests out there that are any good, because if there were, we'd all be doing them. But I think before you even look at that, you've got to look at people's lifestyle and their education on their own health. I've just come back from Phoenix yesterday, day before, can't remember, jet lag. But I was in a Whole Foods there, and I was with somebody locally there, and after we'd paid for everything, I looked back at the line of cashiers taking the money, and honestly, every single one of them must have been over £300. Every one of them. And not in a good way. And I'm sitting there thinking, this is supposedly a health food place, and on the shelves, all I can see is pancake mix and waffles and all this kind of stuff. But because it's in Whole Foods, it must be healthy, and it's far from it. And you've got these people that are working in this place, clearly will get a discount on the goods in there, and you would expect them to be a little bit more healthy themselves. And I'm not saying that you don't have freedom of choice and you can put in your mouth what you please. What I'm saying is their education and their understanding of what is healthy is where the problem lies to start with. If they don't have the issues to start with, then long term, they're never really going to need the blood work because they haven't got the problems, if that makes sense. So generally, we'll get people come to us who do have issues, or they've tried everything. Normally, they'll come to you because they've tried everything to lose weight, or they are in a position where they're very tired all the time. They're not sleeping very well. Their adrenals are shot. They've been very stressed at work. Whatever it is, the normal kind of thing you'll get in someone who's pretty driven, and they're male and female. It doesn't mean they're just male CEOs of companies. And once you get people who have lived a life that's been stressful, then it's always a good idea to get bloods done, because we can see exactly how that's affecting their body. So we'll look at their immune function. Is that being set off by anything? We'll look at their gut intolerances. We'll look at their liver, kidneys, immune functions, I mentioned the white blood cell, glucose intolerance, and just everything, basically. We want to look at everything, see everything's working properly. And what it'll normally do is give us a picture as to what the weakest links are in this particular person's bloods because of the life they've lived. So me and you can live exactly the same life every day, eat the same stuff. But in 5 years' time, mine and yours' bloods will look very different. And it's very individual. So it's no good me giving you a cookie cutter nutritional approach because you're this age, you're this height, you're this weight, you're this activity level, and say, right, well, you need to have 2,400 calories a day, 40-40-20 macro split, away you go. Irrelevant, totally pointless, because you don't know how your thyroid is performing. You don't know how, and this is a great one, right? Thyroid, let's take that for example. Go to the GP or the doctor, and you say, I want my thyroid checked, and they'll check what's called TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone. And that is such an antiquated measurement, it's not even relevant anymore. TSH is the pituitary production of the beginning of thyroid stimulation. So TSH will convert to T4, thyroxine. T4 is a non-active form of thyroid. So if you've got a good GP, he might go TSH, T4, and look at those numbers. But T4 has to travel to the liver and get converted to something called T3. Now, if you Google T3 on the internet, you'll come up with a load of bodybuilding websites because that's what they use to strip fat, right? They'll take T3 in a prep. T3 is the active form of thyroid. And if you've got any liver issues, you won't convert that T4 to T3. So it's all well and good saying you've got TSH at a high level and saying, oh, your thyroid must be fine. But unless you drill into it properly and look at it from a functional medicine point of view, you're not really giving a client the right advice and you're not really getting the right information you need. So by testing properly, you're able to really understand what's going on in these people. Without the testing, it's very much guesswork. And you can, don't get me wrong, do a lot of good work with people by having, I mean, you know, after years of experience, I can look at somebody and I can pretty much tell what their main issues are going to be. Is it going to be glucose metabolism? Is it going to be a bit of liver function? Is it going to be some zinc deficiency? You can just look at people and tell that. But we don't know what else is going on unless we get a good blood count. The other thing that I find works better than anything else for getting very quick results is food intolerance testing. And the majority of people will eat foods on a daily basis that they believe are good for them because they're supposedly healthy and they will be reacting to them badly. So once we know what you react badly to, so what you're producing antibodies to, what you're seeing as, what your body is seeing as an infection or a foreign invader, once we know what for you particularly is causing your problem, we can eliminate that from your diet, and literally overnight people are feeling the complete opposite. So they're going, well, I've woken up, I'm not bloated, I'm not holding water, I'm not groggy, my digestion's a lot better, I've got great energy in the afternoon, I can think more clearly, I can remember what happened last week, all these things are amazing. Oh, by the way, I'm losing weight at the same time, it's crazy. The biggest problem people have is not knowing what is causing them their problems. And when it comes to intolerances, you know, if someone says to you, right, I need to lose some weight, the first thing people normally say is, oh, cut the bread out. Bread normally will bloat people and it will cause problems, and people aren't really good with gluten and wheat. And that's true. But that comes number 10 on a list of most intolerant foods, which means that there's 9 other things worse. And in those 9 other things are things like eggs and dairy, but also walnuts, almonds, corn, grains, that kind of thing. So if I turn around to you and say, right, we're going to do you a diet which is going to be great for you, it's going to be really healthy, I want you to start the day with smoked salmon and scrambled eggs, and then mid-morning, don't get me wrong, this is an example, this is not something I would suggest, right? But many people would. So mid-morning, I want you to have some walnuts and some almonds as a snack. Lunchtime, I want you to have a chicken salad with cucumber, tomatoes, peppers, this, that, and the other. Then after your workout, you need to get a whey shake in you quickly as you can, otherwise your biceps will fall off. You won't get any gains. And then in the evening, I want you to have, I don't know, eggs on toast or something. I don't know, right? So people will make assumptions that that's a healthy-ish sort of diet, and yet every single one of those things is causing an issue with people. And they'll never get slim, they'll never get healthy with any of that, simply because those foods are reacting in them. Now, I've seen people react to things like cucumber. There's nothing in cucumber other than water and fiber, but it still causes a reaction in some people. So you can have your best salad in the world, but if you're eating cucumber and you're reacting to it, you will always, always have the problems. And no one will ever think that. They'll look at your food and go, right, you're having a cucumber salad. What's the problem? So until you've done testing, until you know exactly what's going on, you can't really, in my opinion, give the best advice to getting someone optimized. Now, my moral issue is this. If I know I can give you the best advice by getting you tested, and you tell me you don't want to be tested, I feel as though I'm not going to do my job properly, because now I'm guessing. Right now I'm thinking, right, okay, Joshua, you've got to have, you know, I want you to have this, that, and the other, and I'm going to take out all the known irritants, but I'm not sure if these are going to affect you, but I'm going to take them out anyway just to see. And we're really grasping at straws now. Whereas if I've got your food intolerances, if I've got your bloods, and I can see exactly what's going on, we can make quicker benefit easier because we know exactly where we need to be going. And then if we need to drill into it further, right, if things have changed but they haven't changed as well as we want to, or we're still showing symptoms of issues, then we can look at hormone testing, potentially DNA, which, you know, it has its place, but I'm not a huge, huge fan of. Stool testing. Stool testing, to be honest, is one of the greatest things you can do if you've got issues going on that you don't understand, because it will tell you what's coming out the other end, and that will show a lot of what's going on in your body. For example, if you've got a yeast or fungus infection that you're not aware of, that can change a huge amount of things in your body that can be wiped out with a heavy dose of antifungus medication. You can get rid of it in a few days, and that can be something that if you don't get rid of it can last decades. You know, anything like fungus or yeast that grows in the least fertile environments, so to get rid of it can be quite tough if you're doing it naturally, if you're not aware of it, sorry. So getting rid of it is a good thing. I think I rambled on a bit there.
Yeah, no, I love it, man. So when you say that you know, people don't want the testing, I mean, to me, you know, it would just make sense, right? I mean, we spend so much time, you know, getting to know everything else. You know, if you're a business owner, I mean, we're dissecting every number in our business, every biomark in our business, and, you know, but why wouldn't we want to do that in our body? And I get when people maybe not have known those certain things. Like, I would have never thought until having this conversation with you to go get these food intolerance tests, you know. What's their hesitancy to get these done? I mean, has it always come down to money, or like, why would somebody not want to know this stuff?
Cost. It's just expensive. You know, each one of those is going to cost you around $500.
Okay.
So if you've got three of them done, that's $1,500 before you start. And that's a significant investment. And for some people, it's nothing. They go, yeah, it's fine. Stick it on a card. And I want to, you know, it's important to me to know what's going on. I've suffered this long enough. And you'll find that the longer people have suffered a problem, the more willing they are to spend the money. Where it's useful is by a preemptive approach. So let's get you done now and see what's been going on and stop it getting any worse. Then it becomes cheaper, especially over there, because anytime you go to a doctor, it costs you money, right? I remember, you know, I was driving to the airport in a cab, and he had some radio station on. They were having ads, and one of them was about a healthcare company where everyone split the cost. I don't know. I can't remember what it was called, but basically, all the people put their premiums in every month, and then when there was a bill, it was split across everybody, so it all came out a lot cheaper. So the ad, there's this woman on there saying, "Oh, my husband got cancer, blah blah blah," and the cost, the bill from the hospital was $160,000. And I don't know whether that's a lot or not in the realms of your medical costs, but to me, 160 grand of anything is a lot of money. So how people afford it, I have no idea. Right? Honestly, I would not know. Someone gave me a bill for $160,000 tomorrow to pay something, that I'd have to think hard about how to finance that bill and not, you know, not sell everything that I own, kind of thing. So if you can prevent having those problems, it's going to save someone an awful lot of money. And all of a sudden, $500 on a test isn't expensive.
Yeah, it's you know, it just seems like, at least here in the States, our whole entire medical industry is all after the fact. None of it's preventative, right? You know, with this. So, and I love that you talked about, you know, with the blood tests. You know, like my wife and I, we both get our blood work done regularly, and little things like, okay, so I mean, she's 110 pounds, I'm 180 pounds, and if I ate what she ate, I'd be 250 pounds. You know, right? Because my insulin sensitivity is way different than hers. Our thyroids are different. And those were little things that we never knew and you know, became so, so powerful. Now, as far as the food intolerance testing.
Hang on, Josh. Hang on, mate. Listen, tell me something, right? When you got your bloods done, what did you find out from it that you didn't know?
You know, for me, it was you know, I used to be, and this was about a decade or so ago, I used to be obese, you know, and I lost about 118 pounds and I didn't realize how bad my insulin sensitivity was, right? And well, there's a couple things there. My insulin sensitivity was you know, which I guess makes sense, you know, right? Like I just can't have a lot of carbohydrates, or I get fat. I've got to watch that very closely. And now I'm taking metformin and some things to help counteract that, as well as like you talked about T3. But my hormones, my testosterone, which I would have never guessed. You know, because I started this at 33 years old, so 2 years ago, my testosterone was like 311. You know, my doctor's like, man, I mean, this is, you know, like the age of what a 70-year-old male should be. You shouldn't be here at your age. And that was shocking to me, you know, right? Because I never would have guessed. Because, you know, especially younger males, I think we think of our testosterone levels as an ego thing. Because you think, you know, like for me at least, like I just automatically went to the bedroom. I'm like, no, I'm good there. My testosterone's not low. Yeah. You know, it's like an ego thing. And
can I just say a couple of things? And do you mind us talking about your particular case?
Of course.
Right. So firstly, testosterone has got nothing to do with libido. Right. So just because a young man wants to bang everything that's moving does not mean he's got high testosterone. Right. I'm interested in the fact that you take metformin. Is that self-prescribed or was a doctor prescribed that for you?
That is no, it's prescribed by my physician.
He advised it or you asked him for it?
I asked him for it.
Yeah. Right. So that's self-prescribed. You've gone in there and gone, give me some metformin, right? Because I read that can benefit my blood sugar levels, and it can, right?
Yep.
And then there was something else you mentioned. Do you take TRT then?
I do. Yep. 200 milligrams of cypionate or whatever. Yep.
Okay. The interesting thing with that is the metformin is allowing you to continue to have the carbohydrate. It's not benefiting you. All it's doing is keeping you aesthetically looking the way you want to look. Okay? From a health perspective, you might think about changing your biochemistry to be able to deal with the glucose better rather than giving it medication to allow it to function the way it does. And that's a little bit complicated way of saying, basically, if you change your diet, you wouldn't need the metformin.
Right.
And what would then happen is you would change the underlying function of the mitochondria in your cells, and you'd actually be in a much better place health-wise than you would by taking the metformin. And you would have much better uptake and reabsorption of the glucose that you eat. So it's interesting that a lot of people do exactly what you do. They say, look, this is a glucose disposal agent. I can take it in and it will get the glucose into the cells like insulin does. And therefore, I'll take it because it'll make me better with carbohydrates. But there are, in my opinion, there are better ways of doing it for longevity and health. And that then comes down to our discussion about ketogenesis and a ketogenic diet, and how that can help from not only from a aesthetic perspective, but from a longevity, brain function, central nervous system, you know, all of those great things that come along with it.
Yeah, it's, you know, metformin's one of those weird things too, you know, because the research that you do with it, I mean, you know, some who knows? I mean, there seems to be a lot of research that just says that it has so many other benefits, not just with the glucose.
But it has the benefits because it reduces that blood sugar, and the blood sugar is the problem.
Yeah.
That run riot, right? If you're diabetic and you've got high blood sugar, the end result is blindness and amputation. So that's not a good thing to have. And that's what they give diabetics, right? They give them metformin, the type 2 diabetics, give them metformin because that will keep them sorted out and they can continue to eat the donuts.
Yeah.
If you change what went in, you might find that there'd be some significant changes in lots of things that would be positive. And some of those things would be the uptake of nutrients to your cells, would be the aesthetic look that you get, will be the amount of food that you're able to eat properly and the nutrients that you're able to eat. So at the moment, let's take you out of the equation. Let's say there's another client who's taking metformin so that they can take carbohydrate because they want to look full, because that's often why people take it, energy, and they want to look full in the gym or get a pump or whatever else it is. Generally, the nutrient value of carbohydrate is pretty low. It's got a pretty low energy value with 4 calories a gram. And the actual nutrient value of things like oats or white potatoes or rice, white rice, there's not that much vitamins, minerals and stuff in it. Not when you compare it to other foods. So if you could get better foods in with more vitamin, mineral and fiber content that stabilizes your blood sugar better, gives you more of the raw materials to get bigger, stronger, and pumped, it might be worth somebody looking at those alternatives and see if I tweak things and messed about a bit, would I actually be better off doing that rather than putting in the lower value carbohydrate that isn't really giving me what I want anyway because I'm having to manage it with medication.
Yep. Love it, man. Sense. So, when you started talking about the ketogenic diet, you know, right? And we hear a lot about the ketogenic diet. I don't think a lot of people really know what it means and what it means to be in a ketogenic state and whatever. But you know, what always intrigues me about it, or the more that I learn about it, is it's like what's the first thing that they do with somebody that has cancer? Is they put them on a ketogenic diet because sugar then goes out there. I mean, cancer feeds off sugar, so it really makes sense. You know, with that, I mean, is the ketogenic diet really the, you know, if you're looking at overall life longevity, I mean, should that be the focus that people should be going down? Or are you a fan of the ketogenic diet, or does it just strictly come down to their testing and their food intolerances?
Okay, so there are a lot of questions there, and I'm just trying to think of them. Right, so cancer, some cancers are treated very well with a ketogenic diet, others not so much. However, when it comes to longevity, a ketogenic diet can be very useful, and it's shown to extend the life of people and animals because it's such a low glycemic load on the body. In other words, just so little glucose being used and burned as energy that when you burn glucose for energy, you create reactive oxygen species or free radicals in your body by combustion. And those free radicals will cause aging. And that's one of the problems with the way we've evolved, is that we haven't quite come to terms with the fact that every time we breathe oxygen and we burn oxygen, we create things in our body that age us. But it's the same with, if you can keep your blood sugar stable, you will certainly have less free radicals, less reactive oxygen species going around. And therefore, from a longevity point of view, it works great for that. But more importantly, it works very well on your central nervous system and your brain function. So when you bring or you take carbohydrate out of your diet, you no longer run on glucose for energy. Your body will liberate fat from the fat cells, take the glycerol from it, it will go to your liver and it will create ketones. And ketone bodies then become the fuel for your body to work on. And they are very efficient, really efficient. And that's what we were designed to live on in the, you know, from the beginning. We weren't designed to live on 3 meals a day or 8 meals a day or whatever it is that, that people have. Initially, we ate when we found something to eat. And if we didn't find something for 4 days, we didn't eat. Okay, simple as that. And when we did eat, or when we did find something, sorry, you would sit and you would eat the shit out of it, right? You would gorge on that stuff so that you got it all in before either someone else came along and nicked it off you, or an animal come and ate it, or it went rotten. So we were designed to sit around a lot doing nothing and eat a fair bit. The trouble with modern day world that we've got is that we have now got food available to us 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, at very little money, especially the cheap crap food. And we can eat as much as we want. And also that food has been engineered to be very hyper palatable. In other words, we'll eat food and it will hit all the senses that your brain wants more of. And it's not natural, right? And food companies spend millions of dollars making sure that they get that hyper palatability absolutely right. Right, you take Pringles, for example, right? You have them over there. You know for a fact that if you start eating them, you're gonna get through half a tube before you know it, right? That's not because you've got a Pringle deficiency and your body needs Pringles, it's because the taste of that and the way it functions in your brain makes you wanna go, right, I need to eat more and more and more of it. So from a ketogenic perspective, when you take out all the carbohydrate and the crap and you produce ketones in your body, what happens is you have a very, very efficient fuel source that fuels your central nervous system and your brain extremely well. So you find that from a clarity of thought perspective, you can think very clearly. You are able to do a lot of, you know, able to have a lot of focus and do a lot of work for extended periods of time with very little food going in. Okay, so it also brings to a point that it brings down a lot of inflammation in your system, because most of the carbohydrate that we eat causes an inflammatory response in our bodies. So wheat, dairy, gluten, legumes, grains, if you ever looked at paleo, you know they're the main things that you would take out. That's because they cause systemic inflammation in your system. Systemic inflammation will travel to your brain. It goes throughout the body. That's why it's systemic. And that inflammatory response in your brain will give you brain fog, make you not be able to concentrate for long periods of time, make you tired, and that whole sugar roller coaster that you get on a carbohydrate diet, you don't get on a ketogenic diet. It also means that you eat a lot more fat. Fat will liberate 9 calories of energy per gram, as opposed to carbohydrate, which is only 4. So you can eat less. And it's a lot more satiating because it controls your blood sugar level. It doesn't mean you get dips in blood sugar after every meal, so you're not hungry an hour and a half, 2 hours later. So in the afternoon, you've had lunch and it's, you know, I don't know, a can of Coke and a sandwich and a bar of chocolate or something. That's going to spike your blood sugar out of the chart. You're going to get a huge amount of insulin dumped. It's going to lower your blood sugar through the floor, and you're going to be hungry and sleepy by 3 o'clock in the afternoon, which is what most people are, right? And then they go and get a coffee and a donut because they need some sort of energy. On a ketogenic diet, you don't get that. In fact, you don't feel hungry. And I follow it a lot of the time. To be fair, I follow it majority of the time. There are some other factors that mean it doesn't necessarily work well for you, but we can come to that. But so I'll generally eat 2 meals a day. So I'll eat at 1 o'clock and I'll eat at 8 o'clock in the evening, and that's it. And those meals will be somewhere around 1,250 calories per meal. So they're big old meals, but they work really well for me. It means that I don't have to sit there thinking about what I'm going to eat next, and oh, I've got 2 hours until my next meal and all this sort of nonsense, and I'm hungry, because the food I eat stops me from being hungry completely. So that's a real good advantage for people who are trying to maybe maintain their weight or maybe lose a bit of weight. As long as it's done properly, it has some massive, massive benefits from a health perspective. Where people get it wrong is they think they just need to eat lots of fat and they'll lose weight. Calories still are still calories. So if you eat 5,000 calories of butter, you're going to put weight on. It's not, you know, all this bulletproof coffee, that's what you should drink, and Dave Asprey's been 6% body fat for the last 5 years and eats 5,000 calories a day. I'm yet to see any proof that he eats 5,000 calories a day or that he's 6% body fat.
Yeah.
And I'm not having it. Right? I've seen pictures of him. He's nowhere near six, more like 16, right? On a bad day, 26. But he's a great marketer, so good luck to him. But as long as you get it right, then it can have some massive, massive benefits. Where it won't benefit you is if you're trying to have any sort of performance-related goal within some sort of sport. So for argument's sake, for better or worse, my chosen pastime is CrossFit. And that is a very glycolytically demanding pastime. It really hits up that glucose metabolism for energy. So I know if I am ketogenic and I've only eaten fats during that day, my performance will not be as good as if I put in some carbohydrate pre-workout. So when you know how to manipulate it properly, it's not a massive problem. It's just that, say, someone like yourself who's not great with carbohydrate, and nor am I, well, I've had my DNA done and my basic genetics says you're rubbish at carbohydrate metabolism. So from a health and weight management point of view, I'm very much like you. If I eat lots of carbohydrate, I'll get very fat very quickly. But from a performance point of view, you can't excel on a very high fat diet. But what you can do is run a high fat diet the majority of the time, and then pre-workout have a small amount of carbohydrate, 30 grams maybe, a relatively fast releasing carbohydrate that you can use during the workout, and then post-workout, you might want another 20 or 30 grams. And these are very small amounts. When you talk about people who are eating 200, 300, 400, 500 grams a day, I'm talking about 20 or 30 grams pre and post workout, which allow you to do the job and then recover slightly afterwards and then go back onto a fat diet. And that means that your metabolic flexibility, in other words, the way you burn fat for fuel and the way you burn glucose for fuel, is very well controlled. Whereas with most people, they burn glucose only and they tend not to burn any fat. And you'll find that in 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 years, they've put on 20, 30, 40, 50, 100 pounds. And yet they've been to the gym and they've done this, that, and the other, but their body's always just burned glucose and just stored all the fat. And there's lots of different reasons for it. But from a ketogenic point of view, it's great for longevity. It's great for appetite suppressing because it doesn't make you very hungry because your blood sugar is pretty good. Your energy levels are pretty steady, great cognitive function, and it's just an easy thing to follow.
Yeah, and I started recently doing a lot of intermittent fasting, and you know, it was a push getting my body used to it. You know, right? It took a couple weeks to get rid of those hunger pains and whatever, but man, it did the opposite of what I ever felt. Like the energy is through the roof, and like you talk about with the brain function and the clarity that you get. You know, it's just insane. So I love it, man. When you're talking about, okay, so you're doing CrossFit, so you're going working out.
So sorry, John, I'm going to butt in again, right?
Okay.
We will come back to CrossFit, I promise you. So you intermittent fast, right? So what are your timings? You not eat in the morning and then you eat in the afternoon, or how do you
run? Yeah, my last meal will be like 8 o'clock in the evening, and then I'll usually go till 2 or 3 the next day before I have my first meal.
All right, so that's a really good time, right? You're giving it a good 15-20 hours of fasting every day, right?
Yep.
Really interesting. Then I would love to see your bloods after you've done that for 3 months, right? Because what you're doing is you are doing the right thing, by the way, is you're creating better insulin sensitivity in your system. Because when you fast like that, and I intermittent fast as well, I love it. I think it's brilliant. Right? There's some days I'll just have one meal if I'm busy, and I don't even notice it. Right? Honestly, it's not even a problem. And but what you're doing is, by having a long extended period that you're not eating, you're not bathing your cells in glucose the whole time. So if you're eating, so typical bodybuilding diet, six meals a day, you've got to eat every 2 hours or every 3 hours, whatever else it is, you're never empty. You're always eating some sort of carbohydrate. Whereas what you're doing is you're saying, well, I'm not going to eat anything for 16, 18 hours. And that gives your body a chance to flush out all the glucose that's there, go into something what's called autophagy, which is the cellular detoxification and clear out of all the dead debris. So any broken DNA, any cells that are dead in the earth, it gets a chance to sweep it out and get rid of it. And it also gets a chance to pick up all the bits that are still working and then put them back together and make new bits out of it. Very, very clever. But so that kind of comes in after about 12 hours. So you're giving it a really good chance to detoxify. You got a really good chance to improve your insulin sensitivity. So the reason I'm saying I'd be really interested in your bloods after a while is because you are doing the job that metformin is doing.
Yeah.
And therefore you don't need that metformin because you're creating it yourself, but you're doing it in a much better way. And I would suggest, well, okay, I won't say it's for you, but for me, certainly, when I eat, I like to eat properly. I want to feel stuffed, right? I don't want to eat 400 calories and then be looking at my watch thinking I've still got another 3 hours until my next meal and I'm still hungry. I want to sit down and I want to eat a meal that makes me feel like I've eaten properly. And intermittent fasting allows me to do that because I can fast all morning, eat at 1 o'clock, and like I said before, I can eat 1,250 calories. And that is a big old meal, right? Even though I'm eating fat and the volume isn't as much as if I was eating carbohydrate, it's still very, very satiating. I don't feel hungry after that, I can assure you. And then by 8 o'clock in the evening, I'm ready to eat again and I can do the same again and still feel satiated from it. And that's the same kind of thing with a lot of people. Getting them to be compliant on a nutrition plan is the most important thing. I can give you the best nutrition plan for you, but if you don't follow it, pointless, right? But if you've got a plan that allows you to eat till you feel stuffed, have the most amount of energy you've ever had, lose weight, stabilize your blood sugar levels, and you can follow because you enjoy it, then that's a win all round, right? Intermittent fasting allows a lot of people to do that, especially the ones that put on weight easily. And you'll find that people like me and you who are sensitive to carbohydrate work very well with intermittent fasting because you'll be similar to me in that when you eat, you want to eat properly, right?
Yeah.
You don't want to graze. Screw that. I want to eat, I want to sit down, and I want to feel stuffed at the end of it. And intermittent fasting allows you to do that because you've got two big meals. What's your kind of calorie intake?
I'm you know, like, okay, my first meal today is going to be, I've got smaller patties, but they're two grass-fed, you know, beef hamburger patties that I cooked up last night that I'm going to have for meal, my first meal. And then yep. My second meal of the day, my last meal of the day will be, you know, probably some steak tonight with a tiny bit of spinach salad, you know, right? So I, you know, but no, I'm not counting specific calories with that.
So for your first meal, you're just going to have two burger patties?
Yeah, that's what I have today. It's not always the same, but that's what I have today.
And nothing else?
Nothing else today, no.
Okay, interesting.
Yep.
So I'll give you an example of what I eat, right? Because I'd probably still be hungry with what you're doing. So I will, and I love it because it's so simple. I will get a bag of salad, take half a bag of salad, put it on a plate. I will dress it with what I like, macadamia nut oil, avocado oil or avocados, one or two tins of wild mackerel or wild sardines, whatever else it is. And that'll be my meal, if you like. And then I'll follow it because I don't eat dairy and I don't eat eggs because I'm intolerant to both of them. And then on a ketogenic diet, most of it is heavy cream, eggs, you know, all that kind of stuff, butter. But I don't eat that. So what I'll do alongside that salad and fish meal is I will have coconut yogurt with some chocolate superfoods that we do over here, which are really, really good. So I'll mix that in there with some almond butter, put some blueberries on it, and that as a dessert, if you like, is phenomenal. And those two together will hit up around 1,000-1,200 calories. And if you showed me two beef patties, I would probably say to you, where is the rest of it?
Yeah. Well, like I said, usually it's a little bit heavier than that, but sometimes it's it goes light like that. But I mean, I'm one of these guys too that I it's weird. I used to feel like I needed a lot of food, you know, but I found my body doesn't just need near as much as I used to think, which has been insane. And then, you know, I'm curious though with that amount of, you know, with you eating those two meals a day, because you're also, you know, if you are listeners and go to your website, I mean, dude, you're a big muscular but also very lean guy. And we have this, you know, a lot of guys, and I had this for a long time too, of, oh no, I need to get in that protein every couple hours, you know, right, to go out there and do that. But is that obviously it's working for you, just having those two or smaller meals a day, it's not hindering your muscle growth.
No, overall protein intake is what's important, and people don't need as much protein as they think they do. However, if you own a whey protein supplement company, you will go to big lengths to tell people how much protein they need to take in and how regularly.
Yeah.
And buy my product, please, because that's what's going to do it for you. So, and by the way, whey protein is one of the biggest irritant foods that we find on people's tests, like off the chart with whey protein. So if you ever get bloated, get gas, or anything like that after eating a whey protein shake, that's why you're doing that. That's what's causing it. Pretty much guarantee it. That and eggs. So where was I? Yeah, so you don't need as much protein as you think, and you certainly don't. You certainly won't lose your muscle mass. The thing that builds muscle is hitting the gym and lifting heavy weights. And if as long as you do that, your body will continue to repair. Now, we can drill into a really, really deep rabbit hole about what happens with gluconeogenesis and the breakdown of muscle to fuel certain activities in the body if you haven't got much carbohydrate in. But honestly, we could use one podcast on that. So just know that as long as you get a reasonable amount of protein in, a gram a pound is more than enough. But I mean, it's actually excessive, a gram a pound. So if you're 175 pounds, 180 pounds, and you're eating 175 grams of protein in a day, that's way more than enough. You get away with 0.8, 120, 130 grams a day, and that will sustain muscle growth for sure, right? But people get over the top with it. The other thing that people get over the top about protein is that it makes you feel fuller for longer. Well, I'm not a mad advocate of that. You know, it makes you feel as full as it takes for it to get digested. What does make you full for a long time is fat.
Yeah.
So by using fat in the right way, eating the right amount of protein, and then making up any kind of small deficit you need with carbohydrate if you need to, I find that people work a lot better like that. But intermittent fasting for you, fantastic, mate. Really, really good idea.
So then you've got your two meals a day. So you're fasting, then you eat your two meals a day, but then when you're doing CrossFit, so those two big meals a day, and then do you have a pre and post meal before you work out, or are you in a fasted state when you're doing that?
Yeah, so it all depends. Okay, so we'll get a slightly different subject. But basically, I train about 9 times a week. And I'm going to mention this because it's important for people to understand the background. So I train 9 times a week. I'll do 3 CrossFit classes. I'll do 3 weight training. And I'll do 3 cardio of steady state stuff, because the CrossFit is the HIIT training. And that's a lot to fit in 7 days, and it's a lot to recover from, right? Especially when you're 50 years old. So unless you've got a pretty good idea as to what fuels your body well in performance and recovery, it kind of can be very difficult to do, right? So if I'm like today, I'm not training CrossFit tonight. I trained already today. So it's now 3:20 in the afternoon here. I ate before we got on the air. I'm not training now for the rest of today. I've got calls and stuff to do. So I'll have one meal later on. But if I was training, I would probably have, well, not probably, I'd definitely have something before I train. And the likelihood is that would be a very small amount of carbohydrate along with some caprylic acid, which is an MCT oil, one of the oils that make up coconut oils, called C8 caprylic acid. And what that does is that pushes up ketones in your body. So ketones are a fuel source, as is carbohydrate. So I would use that as my pre-workout. And then post-workout, I would have my meal. And whatever the calories are within that oil and pre-workout would kind of count towards my day's sort of calorie intake. So I might have slightly less later on. But on a day where I'm just doing, say, cardio and weights, then I would probably not bother too much about timing. It doesn't really matter. So long as you're getting it in within that 24-hour period and it's not a performance-related goal, then when you're weight training, you can have them before, after, during, whatever you want to do. It doesn't really make a difference.
So those that small amount of you know, carbohydrates pre and post workout, does that throw you out of a ketogenic state, or does that allow you to keep you in there?
In that moment, it will throw you out for sure, but it get burnt so quickly that you'll soon be back in it. The thing people don't realize is, have you seen the book Carb Night or Carb Backloading? John Kiefer, no? Okay. So some while ago, there's a guy called John Kiefer wrote a book called Carb Night, and it was basically you eat less than 30 grams of carbohydrate a day for 6.5 days, and then on the end of this 6.5 day, you have a whole load of carbohydrate. So you basically don't eat any, and then you throw a load in at the end. And they said, yeah, that will make you lose weight, and you can eat cheesecake on that day, and you'll be fine. And it was touted as something that allows you to eat all the food you want at one time of the week, but still lose weight. Now, what people don't understand is when you're getting into ketosis, it doesn't take 2 or 3 days. It takes months for you to adapt. So you really need to load this phase of 6 months before you start seeing any kind of performance-related changes, because it takes that long for your mitochondria to upregulate themselves and use fat effectively. People that say, I'm keto, I haven't eaten carbs for 3 days. Yeah, you're not keto, you haven't got a clue what you're doing, right? So you need to really be committed to it for a long period of time. And by the way, after about 2 or 3 days, you will feel like crap, because there'll be a point where you've got no glucose and your body hasn't started to produce ketones. And that's where you get this thing called keto flu, where people just feel dreadful. And they don't get past that because they feel so bad. They go, I've got to have some sugar, I've got to eat something. Now, there is a way through that, and that's by either taking exogenous ketones, which you can buy as a supplement, or by taking some C8, like caprylic acid, because that will bump up your ketones a bit more quickly as well. But you really need to be looking at doing kind of 4 to 6 months of really good deep keto so that you adapt properly. Once you've done that, you're then able, for people like us, people who are sensitive to carbohydrate, you're then able to have a bit of carbohydrate, do your workout, and know that you'll drop back into ketosis within about 3 or 4 hours after that. If you weren't adapted, as soon as you start eating carbs, it will take you another 3 or 4 days to get back into it, which means that if you had carbs every 3 days, you'd never be in ketosis, because it would take you that long to burn it. So you do need to do that phase at the beginning, and especially for people like us who are sensitive to carbohydrate. However, what I find when you're looking at recovery from workouts is using nucleotides is by far the best way to facilitate better recovery from anything that you do. And people don't realize the understanding behind it. Nucleotides are the molecules necessary to build new cells in the body. Okay, so you have DNA, which sends a message to RNA, which sends a message to the body to produce a protein, okay, to produce a cell. This is a very shortened version. This is not a biochemistry lesson, right? So I've really cut out a lot of the sequences. But the bottom line is, in every signal that goes on, you need 3 billion nucleotides to facilitate it. Now, that sounds like a large number, but when you're talking about cellular terms, that's pretty normal. But without them, you will not generate the new cells quick enough. And we do get nucleotides in our food, but it comes from things like offal, those things like liver, kidneys, heart, lung, that kind of thing, stuff that we don't really eat that much of. And even if you do eat it, you don't get enough of them in the right proportions. There's five main nucleotide molecules that you need, and you get two of them or three of them, but you don't get them all in the right levels. So by supplementing with it, we've seen huge amounts of improvement in gut health, recovery, muscle protein synthesis, nutrient uptake, immunity, everything. And honestly, for nothing else, I believe that is the one thing that allows me to train as often as I do, as hard as I can, and still maintain some sort of health and ability to function and not do like 9 sessions in a week and be completely wiped out. And there, that's a huge, huge benefit. And when it comes to things like ketosis, it helps with the nutrient uptake. It helps with, like I say, the gut lining. So your gut lining changes every 3 to 4 days, the cells in there. If you've got any gut problems, if you've got IBS, if you've got bloating, if you've got any sort of leaky gut kind of syndrome, it's because the villi, which are the things that stick up in your gut, are broken and aren't regenerating properly, and you've got permeability in the cells in the gut wall. Whereas what this stuff does is it builds them back up. And you can see within 2 or 3 weeks, huge differences. So again, better uptake of nutrients, better gut health, better immunity, better recovery. It's just the benefits are endless. So that, I think, makes a huge difference for me personally.
Yep, love it. So with that nucleotide, I mean, do you have, you know, because I know our listeners will ask, I mean, do you have, you know, certain ones that you recommend that you take, that if somebody's listening to this right now saying, hey, you know, I'm going to go get on that right away. I mean, is there certain ones that you recommend?
Yeah, if you, there's only one that's available. And it's called XL, X-CELL, and it's from Switzerland, manufactured there. I know the factory very, very well. We've done a lot of work with them. I love the product. I think it's amazing. In the States, you can get it from a website called Morelli Fit, which is run by a guy called Mike Morelli, who's a very nice chap, and they sell it on their website, and you can just order it through there and try it out. Seriously good product. I work a lot with Mike. That's why I've just gone over there to sit with him and educate his audience. He's got like 2 million followers that are very health related, and we've just been out there doing videos for them and telling them about why this product is what it is. But I think if you're going to do anything in your health, this product is going to be something that's going to be something you should not go without.
Yeah, love it, man. So have you ever met anybody that doesn't have some type of a food intolerance? I mean, is it one of those things where every single human being essentially is intolerant to something?
No. Do you know what? I have met people that aren't intolerant to stuff, and that's really annoying. Because they come to us with a problem, and you go, "Ah, well, I know exactly what that's going to be. Let's get you tested, and that will tell us what the problem is." And my fiance had a lot of gut issues, right? And of all the people in the world that you want to be able to cure, it's your missus, right? And I'm sitting there thinking, we've tried everything, and we know everything, and this is ridiculous. So she gets her food intolerances done, and nothing is reacting. And then now I'm scratching my head thinking, okay, this is not right. This is crazy. I was sure there was going to be something reactive. But what we did find in her bloods is there was a immune reaction going on, and you could see that there were certain things that were showing themselves that meant that even though there was no intolerance to a particular food, there was a systemic issue going on. And we were then able to turn around and say, right, let's put you on a FODMAPs diet, which takes out a lot of the irritant fibers and sugars and certain other things, and that will then balance off what's happening in your bloods, and you'll see some big benefits. So the intolerances didn't show anything, but her bloods did, and that allowed us to get that fixed, yep. Which she wasn't overly happy with because it meant she couldn't eat avocado, but celibate, she feels better.
Yeah. When would, because I know you talk about DNA testing, like when would that ever come into play for somebody?
Well, a lot of people ask for DNA testing because they're interested to know from a genetics perspective how their health and fitness goals can be achieved better. But what DNA testing will do is it will tell you your proportion of power to endurance ratio within your muscles. It will tell you your carbohydrate sensitivity genetically. It will tell you your fat sensitivity, so how good you are with those two products, whether or not you need B vitamins to help with methylation, whether or not you have the enzymes that produce vitamin D, the ability to digest lactose, so dairy, any propensity to celiac issues, which is gluten. And it'll tell you a load of things, your injury risk, what things you might need for recovery, that kind of thing. And it's fine, it has a place, but here's my challenge with it. You could, in your DNA, could be that you've got really good insulin sensitivity, right? You can eat carbs and sugar till the cows come home from a genetic perspective. But if you sit on the sofa and eat donuts every night for 40 years, the likelihood is your behavior will change your genetic expression. In other words, you will still cause some kind of insulin resistance because of the amount of sugar that you've eaten. Even though genetically you should be fine, you can still cause that issue. So for us, it's all well and good knowing your genetics, but I want to know what you're doing today, what's your behavior and what it has caused. Your genetics don't take into account your stress or your lifestyle. It just says this is what you were born with. But if you stress yourself out for the last 30 years, your adrenals are shot, you know, your adrenaline and your cortisol levels are through the roof, and everything in your system is fried, and your liver's getting fatty, that's nothing to do with genetics. That's to do with the fact that you've had a high-stress job, you've drank lots of alcohol, you've eaten lots of crap food, and your behavior has created the environment that you're now living in, and that's what we want to deal with, not what you were born with.
Yep, love it, man. So, you know, like you said earlier, you know, you could literally have a separate podcast on every single one of these topics, man. So this has been awesome, man. A lot of information, amazing information thrown at us. What's the best place, Paul, for our listeners to, if they want to learn more about you, if they want to get in touch with you, if they want to start working with you and get some of this testing done, as I really think everybody should. Yep. You know, what's the best place to get a hold of you and to learn more about that?
The best place would be athleticnutrition.tv, as in television. That's the website. It's a very basic one. There's no point in us throwing lots of information on there because it would just get ridiculously confusing. So it tells you the basics about what we do. And then you can contact me through that. I've got a podcast on iTunes, the Athletic Fitness and Nutrition Podcast. So you can hook into that and have a listen. Lots of different topics, lots of good guys on there, well worth listening to. Twitter, Athletic Nutri. You can find me on Facebook, Athletic Nutrition, or just under my name, Paul Burgess. So yeah, just by all means, get in touch. Very happy to do. We've got loads of clients in the States and all over the world that we do testing for. More than happy to do it. Love getting people to know what's going on and see the changes that happen. It's, you know, for me, that's why we do the job. We don't do it for the money. The money's nice and it pays the bills. But when you see somebody who's been struggling for 20 years with IBS and 3 weeks later they're saying that I've not had an episode and I think it's phenomenal and I feel amazing, that's the stuff that we love. So the more of that, the better. And if you want to get in touch, then yeah, by all means.
Yeah, and even if something's not going on, right? I mean, it's still, because it just seems like so many of the age-related diseases, not so many of them, almost all of them, could be preventable through lifestyle, you know, atherosclerosis and all these things that we see, if people really just got intentional and were proactive with this stuff.
Absolutely. Let me just say something about anti-aging, if you like, right?
Yeah.
there's a book called Blue Zones. Have you ever read it?
No.
Okay, so there's a study done. It's like a meta-analysis. So a meta-analysis is the commonalities between lots of different studies, right? So let's say you get 50 research papers and you look at what everything is common between them and you take that information. And they did a meta-analysis on the five populations that live the longest in the world. And they went from places in Middle East, I think, and Indonesia and all around the world, right? Greece was one of them. And they looked at people that lived to over 100 years old but were healthy. And they wanted to find out what was the commonality between them. What did they all have in common? And they found out five basic things. One was they ate less than they needed. So there was a mild calorie deficit. Okay, they weren't stuffing their face every day. Two, they always sat down and ate with their family. That was the key. Everybody sat down at the same time at the table and ate. They weren't on their iPads. They weren't watching telly. They were sitting there and eating. They all had a purpose in life, a significant purpose. Now, that might have been that they've got to go and milk the goats that day, or they've got to go and harvest of whatever, right? But they had a purpose, a drive. They all had daily physical activity, which meant that they were doing some sort of exercise, not going to the gym, but they were living a life of physical activity. And lastly, they had a very active community spirit. In other words, they were very involved with the community around them, and everyone would get together and everyone would know each other, and a huge support network. But the interesting thing was the food that they ate was all different depending where they came from. So some people were eating very high carbohydrate, some people were eating very high fat, some people were eating a mixture. It didn't really matter. It was the lifestyle factors that were causing them that longevity. And generally what happened was they'd get to an old age and then they wouldn't get very sick. They would get just a declination of health and then die very quickly. So it wasn't like they were sick for years and years and years. There are people dancing on tables at 95 years old, you know, and probably having a good time. And eventually, you know, time would pass and then that would be the end of their life. But it was a very active life. So when we look nowadays at anti-aging, which for me is really interesting because I'm getting old and I don't want to be old, right? My goal is to do weighted pull-ups at 50 years old. If I can get that done, I think everything else will fall into place. So if I had started 25 years ago by managing blood sugar levels, by not doing too much stuff that causes too much stress on the body and everything else, that would have allowed me to be even better than I am now, and going forward would allow me to live even longer. So the keys are making sure that what you're doing is putting your body under as less stress as possible. Okay, for me honestly the worst thing I do is CrossFit because it really causes that reactive oxygen species. But I do a lot on the other side that allows me to try and counteract it. But I enjoy it and I'm not going to give up my life for it. But it's massively important to look at the lifestyle, see what you're doing, do the stuff that you know you're in control of, chill out a bit. You know, think money's not that important. Being the best at your job isn't necessarily that important. And when you do relax a bit, you tend to find that things come into your life that give you all the things you want anyway. So for all your entrepreneurs out there that are killing themselves working 18 hours a day, that's all very nice, but you're never going to get time to spend it because you're either going to be working or you're going to be too sick.
Yeah.
So take your foot off the pedal a bit, work smart, not hard, get the most out of everything that you do, but start enjoying your life along the way. Because if you're going to put in 10, 20 years of trying to build a business, you look back, 20 years has been wasted. You might have all the money in the world. If you haven't got the health to spend it, what's the point? And why not live a life every day rather than waiting until you're 20 years down the line and you've got $1 million?
Yeah.
And people need to get that perspective because you'll be a lot happier. Trust me.
Yep. Love it. Powerful words, my friend. So those watching and listening, we'll have links that to Paul's website, all his information, social media links, all below. So that way you can just click on those, connect with Paul. Definitely go check out his website. I highly recommend that you guys go out there and get tested. You know, like I said, I've been personally getting my blood work done for a couple of years now. I've never done the intolerance test. So I'm definitely going to get with you and get that going, man. Cause I'm
let me know and I'll get something sent out to you.
Yeah. I would love it. Love it. So, so, you know, and yeah, I know to our audience in every podcast with this, you guys, but information without implementation is just the start of delusion. Information is not power. It's taking that information, taking action on it inside your world that creates power. And Paul shared so many just amazing pieces of advice that can help you go out there and improve your life dramatically. Take action on some of the things that he said. Like he said in the podcast, he can give you the keys to the kingdom. He can give you all the information, but if you don't do it, you're not going to get the results. So make sure you take some action on what he shared with you. Definitely go check out his website. And Paul, I know how busy you are, man. It's a true honor having you on the show, my friend. This has been a great time.
Pleasure, man. And listen, if you ever need anything else or we want to chat about something else, just let me know. It's always good fun to get it out there and start helping people. So Just give me a shout, man.
Yeah, we'll definitely have to do that, my friend. Thank you so much. We really appreciate it. And we'll see you guys next time.